Please stand and let's give the pledge allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, folks. My name is Ken Weber, and of course I work with the Florida Forest Service, and I'm responsible for field operations in the panhandle for the Florida Forest Service, and that includes the Tate State Forest. I first came to Franklin County in 1995. Tony Millender in the back here, some most of you probably know, we're just reminiscing how quick that went. He remembers when I was dumped off in Lanark Village, and literally the rangers from Central Florida said, here you go, and dumped me off in my little apartment. And I was the first guy they hired to manage the new forest called Tate's Hill. And you know, through the years, land managers work out in the woods, and they do a lot of stuff. A lot of times they don't see anybody all day long. A lot of times they're coming in, they'll see somebody fishing in the ditch, or maybe some hunting during hunt season, or hiking or biking. And we, you know, we smile, we realize that people are enjoying it, but it's not often when we have land management reviews or some new proposal that we get a group of people that really enjoy the forest that come together. So just want to start with that and just thank you for coming out tonight, because that shows that you do care about your forest land and what we're trying to do to manage it. So appreciate that. So tonight, why we're here is to discuss this memo of understanding that the Florida Department of Agriculture, Consumer Services, Florida Forest Service, and the U.S. Air Force had signed back in October 2012. And we'll get through that, and we'll try to hopefully, you know, everybody understand the process and what that really means. And we have a lot of folks here that are going to help us out, and we're going to describe a little bit about everybody's sort of scattered right now. So Mike Penland from the U.S. Air Force and John Mather, they're going to explain that side of the agreement. Jim Carls is our director, and David Core, he's going to keep everybody on track on their speaking. He's our assistant director sitting up front. And John Brown is our land acquisition manager and special projects manager. And I do also want to take the moment, as I started, folks on the ground managing the land, to introduce really the managers on the ground. And Chris Colburn in the back, he's our Tallahassee Center manager. And Randy Gregory, he's the guy on the ground here in Franklin County to go to. He's our operations administrator, so he oversees KSL and Franklin County operations. And Todd Schroeder is our public information officer, and he's also our mitigation specialist. And Tony Millender, he was the guy managing Tate Cell when it first started. So, and he's now retired and joined the good life. So if you at break or so, you want to have a good comment about Tate Cell, go tell them about it, because they're out there working it every day. Okay. What I want to do is go through just the documents that you should have received real quickly when you walked in. Okay, the first one will be the agenda. Okay, it has our logos on top. Everybody have one of those? If you don't have this, please, you know, get up front and get a copy. Another one is the only, that I know of, David, correct me, official document. Because I know some people saw some drafts, the emails that were not official, the drafts that were never implemented, that has been signed. And we'll go through this a little bit. It's just a memo of agreement to explore options. And you've got extras, if anybody needs them. And the last sheet is a little briefing sheet, two pages, or both sides. just kind of goes through, you know, what has occurred to this point, what are the frequently asked questions, where we're at. So there's a lot of basic information you can read while you're sitting there, and maybe that'll help you form the questions you have that you would like to ask tonight. That wasn't the last one. The last one, I lost mine. This is stable here. Yeah, this one. If you wish to speak tonight, we ask you to fill out the form. And I know a lot of you don't like to get up and speak, but even if you have a question you would like to ask in front of everybody, if you would fill that out, and we'll send them around again, because the guys are going to go through their introduction, and then we're just going to move on to the next. And then, you know, the mic's yours. Mr. Core is going to track the time, and after 2.5 minutes, you'll see the yellow. Say 30 seconds. At that point, you really need to start winding it down. Get your last point in, and then at 3 minutes, we'll get the stop sign. And we'll cut you off. And if you have questions, get those questions out, because we're going to have some answers, or hopefully have some answers. Try to answer all your questions. So, if you saw this and were intimidated and said, I'm not going to speak, but I do have questions, grab one of these forms, write your questions on it. And are we taking any written comments tonight?
Yeah. Yeah, they can use it for that.
They can use it just for writing, or if you still want to get up and ask some questions, fill it out. I think we only have 10 or 12 people that wish to speak, so we got time. We're going to go until 8 o'clock, until all the questions are asked, whatever comes first. So, with that, I'll turn it over to Mike and let him start the interview.
Can everybody hear me if I not use the microphone, or do I need to use the microphone? Can everybody hear me? Okay. So, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Mike Penland. I work at Headquarters Air Force. I'm the Chief of Operational Basing, and I'm the government lead for GRASI, the Gulf Regional Airspace Strategic Initiative. So I'm going to make this fairly quick because I want to spend as much time as possible answering your questions if we can. So real quickly, we started this thing. The overall GRASI project was a couple-year project. One of the things that came out of that particular thing was a landscape initiative, which was basically an idea of trying to figure out if there's opportunities out there to partner with state, local, private landowners, managers, those kind of folks, to try to give us flexibility to complete missions that we think we are going to have trouble with in the future. That's really the idea of the landscape thing. So I want to thank everybody for coming out, because we're willing to get your inputs and try to answer questions. I know last time that the scoping meeting format was not that great. Folks wanted to have a chance to have some interaction. So I talked to Commissioner Sanders, and I appreciate being here tonight as well. And we talked about having this town hall meeting so that you guys can ask questions and we can try to answer questions as much as we can. So I appreciate that. I appreciate all the Forest Service guys and Jim Carl's being here as well. I just want to say real quick that I know there's a little bit of confusion, but in the environmental impact statement process, we are very early in the process. There's still a whole lot of time left. At the end of our process for the Air Force, all that's going to allow me to do is then go to the Forest Service and say, we have been able to look at a bunch of different places, we've done a bunch of analysis, here's what we propose, what do you guys think? So at the end of this environmental process, that's all we get. It's still the Forest Service and the state of Florida that gets to say yes or no. So please realize that this EIS process is not the end of it. This is just our process we have to go through before we can make a coherent proposal to the state of Florida. So hopefully that clears that up. And if you got more questions on it, I can answer them. So, next.
John Brown.
John Brown.
Need the mic, it's up there. I think I get by without it. Can you guys hear me? I started here in 1957. No, actually, I was born here. I'm from Franklin County, from Apalachicola. I worked down with Florida Forest Service. Been there about 13 years. We became aware of this in December 2011. The United States Air Force met with the governor's office and briefed them on a project that they had called GRASI, the Airspace Strategic Initiative.
GRASI that we've come to know it now. And what was happening at that time, the Air Force was getting inundated with new missions because of bases closing all over the United States, and mission change. They were starting to load up England with new missions. They got the Joint Strike Fighter, they got Air Force Special Operations Command, they got Army Special Ops, and a lot of other things going on there. What they did was they said, we've got all these missions that we have to have on the range. We've got some things going on that are non-hazardous. Maybe we can move those off the range and move them on other lands. There was a series of meetings that took place after that original meeting with the governor. And the governor said, go meet with him, talking to his agencies, see if there's common ground, see if we can put something together where maybe our goals and their goals would mesh, and we can assist them, and we can be good partners with the military. The military promotes about 50% of the total economic package in Northwest Florida. It's a pretty big deal. So they're good partners to have. We got involved with them in the summer, mid-2012, with other agencies, with FWC, with their management districts, with everybody else that were managing big chunks of land. We're looking at what they wanted to do, what we had that may be up their alley, what they wanted. We found out that with what we had, Blackwater and Tatesail met the criteria for being close to Eglin, having the right ground cover types, the right land masses. And so that's where we started. We were looking at those. In October of 2012, the commissioner, we briefed the Commissioner of Agriculture. We entered into a memorandum of understanding, memorandum of agreement, with the military to identify certain activities that we thought may be commensurate with what they needed to do off of Eglin. And they went from there and had their NEPA plan, their scoping process, which was a meeting that we had here. We also had one in Milton, had one in Bluntstown, generated a lot of interest in what happened. There were a lot of questions, no answers. And created a lot of bad blood. It was a mistake, but it was a mistake that had to happen because that's the way the government regulations are written. It's the way the federal government operates. So we've come in now and decided that we would have two public meetings. We had one last night in Milton, having one here tonight to try to answer questions and allay fears. To allay some of the fears, Happy touched on it a little bit. Everything that they even would remotely consider doing has to be considered in a NEPA process, which produces an environmental impact statement. That process is ongoing. Sometime in 2014, early 2014, we're thinking spring or summer, there will be a draft environmental impact statement that comes out with draft ideas. We will not even start to formulate a solid draft until sometime after that. Okay, so we're still very early in the process. And what we're here to do tonight is to try to answer the questions as to where we are, where we're going, where we're going, when we're going to get there, what input are you going to have, which is very important. Forest is in your backyard. All your thoughts are very important to us. We want to consider them, we want to hear them, and that's why we're here. So nothing's going to happen tomorrow, nothing's going to happen next week or next month, but it's an ongoing process. So, John?
Thanks. So my name's John Mathers. I've been working for Mike Penland on this for quite some time. And one of the things that Mike said early on in the process is that we've been working on this for 8 years. So. In 2005, when BRAC changed the mission at Eglin Air Force Base, we started trying to figure out how to get everything done at Eglin Air Force Base. So we looked at it for probably, 3 years? We did a lot of modeling. We spent 3 years talking to everybody that needed something at Eglin Air Force Base, everybody that lived and worked and trained and tested at Eglin Air Force Base. We tried everything. We talked to the FAA, we talked to all the local airports, we talked to the Airline Pilots Association, Aircraft Owners and Operators Association. We worked with everybody that had a stake at Eglin Air Force Base and in that region for about 3 years to try and make everything fit into the ranges and airspace that we had that were dedicated for our use. What we realized at the end of it was there was still a set of things that in the coming years we could not do. So when Brack brought things to Eglin, there were things that started there and will continue to grow. So we have organic mission growth as well as mission growth from things that were brought to Eglin Air Force Base. And now as the F-35 starts to come in and the mission at Tyndall starts to change, that those the operational tempo in those airspaces and ranges that we own and manage for our use is continues to ramp up. So we realized that about 2016-2015 time frame that there was a good chance if things went as planned, if the missions coming in went as planned, that we would not have enough ranges and airspace to do what we needed to do. So we started sorting through the bucket of what all happened on our range and in our airspace, and we realized that some of these things did not necessarily have to happen in enclosed spaces. So if you think about the military, it's kind of like a basketball team, right? The guards go practice their personal skills, the forwards go practice their personal skills, the centers go practice their personal skills, and then they get together, and we're seeing a better thing about it as a football team. So the receivers go do their thing, and the line does their thing, and the quarterbacks go do their thing, and the running backs. At some point, you got to put the offense together, and they practice together, and then they practice against the defense. At some point, they've got to practice on the whole field, because that's the way they're going to play the game. So when we started looking at all those different things that have to happen to get the military ready to go, as well as all the testing and research and development activities that happen, we realized that some of those little things like the individual units practicing by themselves were happening on our airspace and in our ranges, but those things look very similar to what happens outside of our ranges and airspace. To give you an example, one of the training things that we're looking at is kind of a force-on-force vehicle. It's almost a red and blue team where there's an aircraft up top flying over the top about 20,000 feet looking down and either trying to put these two groups of vehicles together or keep them apart. That sounds pretty simple when you explain it like that, but on a battlefield or in a tactical situation, you can imagine how that's very important to people that are trying to meet the enemy in the proper way. So none of that has anything to do, when you take that out of the military context, that's really not an unsafe activity. So we found all of these things, these non-hazardous activities that were happening, as opposed to the hazardous activities that were happening, like shooting, bombing, lasing, flight tests, flying UAVs, all those have to happen on the ranges. So we went through and we listed all these type of activities and said, well, what do we need to do with these things? Or how, you know, where else, how should we get this done? And we realized that we had a long partnership with non-governmental organizations and state agencies and federal agencies through managing the environment at a regional level. And we approached them and said, okay, so here's some things that we need to do. Is there any opportunities, places for us to do that? And early on, we realized that we had to meet three criteria. One, had to meet the military need. So the military guys that live and work at Eglin Air Force Base can only go so far on a daily basis or on a weekly basis and come back for them to have any time to do anything at the place that they go to. And those activities take a certain amount of time. But think about it, you have to, again, let's use the football analogy. Let's say your practice field is 2 hours away. You need to practice 4 hours. But that means you need 6 hours to do it. Right? So if you extrapolate that, it's only so far that we can get away from their home base in order to do those training. So it had to be within a reasonable distance. It had to have certain tactical properties. So we had to have openings big enough to land helicopters and that sort of thing. The second criteria had to be low to no impact. We've conducted these activities at Eglin Air Force Base for a very long time, and we're very good at it. We have over 17,000 recreators that visit Eglin Air Force Base every year. It's a big place. We have a lot to do there, and we've been very successful at combining conservation, recreation, and military. So there are some things that we do that we can only do there that are hazardous, but we're keeping them there. So the second criteria we realized we had to meet was to be low to no impact. The third criteria was we had to have a willing partner. So we're going to meet those three criteria through the process that we're going through now. And one is we sat down at the end of this GRASI and looked and said, okay, where's all the places that would meet our criteria? We drew a circle 150 nautical miles around the Air Force Base for certain type of activities. Said, okay, this is only so far as we can go. We did analysis, so we only drive 2 hours away. So, and then we presented that to all the federal and state agencies, and the Forest Service was gracious enough to continue to plan with us towards looking at these things. So our second criteria we call low to no impact. So that is what you see during this process, environmental impact statement. So the purpose of our environmental impact statement is to look at all those things that we need to do that potentially will not fit in our ranges and airspace, that can be moved out safely, and then compare that to the environment and what we know about the endangered species and the wetlands and the soil, and the geology and the water quality and the air quality and the land use and the recreation and the cultural resources, the culturally significant sites. Say, okay, if we do these activities, where are the sensitive areas? And the point is that we would mark those areas out and say, okay, we're not going to operate in this around this thing. We're going to do it differently. We're going to do it a different time of day. We do it a different time of year. We won't go here. We won't do that first thing. But at the end of that, we'll have a set of points, a set of areas that we come back to the Forest Service and say, okay, we have analyzed this and we've studied it. Here's the things that we looked at. Here's the areas we think are low to no impact. At that point, that's when we'll start looking at how we sign permits or leases or whatever that is to make us to get us to be another permitted user in the forest. So here's the schedule we have over here, February of 2014. There's really a three-step process, and John kind of hit on it. One is the scoping that we've already done. So the way we're mandated to do that process is we formulate an action. We go forward, and we have public scoping meetings, and we listen. We say, okay, this is what we're thinking about doing. We want to hear your inputs. And that was that meeting that we had in August. The second step in that process is we take all of those comments. We had a court stenographer that sat right over here, typed in everything everybody said. Take those comments, and we give them to our scientists and engineers and land use people and airspace guys and gals. And they put together a draft environmental impact statement. And that statement will tell you why we're doing, what we're considering doing, what the baseline is, so what the environmental features are, what the potential impacts are, and then we show that to you. And that's what we'll do in February. We come back, we have another meeting, and that's another meeting where we listen again. So there won't be a lot more output from us other than just having the document. So there'll be a hearing, and there'll be a military judge here, and he will take comments. Again, there'll be a court stenographer there typing out everything everybody says. At that point, we'll go back, relook at the document, compare the comments that we received to our analysis and our proposed actions, and we'll incorporate those comments into the draft and release a final. What does that say? I didn't forget the glasses. Release a final sometime in June or next summer. So still no decision has been made. So we release that final. There's a waiting period. You get to comment again. At the end of that, the decision maker will look at all of those comments and sign the document called the Record of Decision. And that Record of Decision will say, this is what we think we can or cannot do in these areas. And that gives us the authority to go to the Florida Forest Service and request those uses. And we anticipate that to be sometime in the fall of next year. So that's a little bit where we are in the process. I'm taking more time than I'm supposed to. Let me talk to you a little bit about the things that the military is studying right now as far as what we need to do what we're looking at as far as what we may do here. So these are the things we're studying, and we're gonna disclose in the draft and the final what the environmental impacts of these things would be, and then as well mitigate those at the end. And if we can't reach a low to no impact scenario, then that's likely that we won't be able to do them. So one of the things that we've heard is about aircraft. So we are looking at how we can fly light aircraft. They're single engine aircraft. They're very small. They're flown by the Air Force Special Operations Command. And their job is to land places where it doesn't look like they could land. So what we're doing, what we're looking at is having these guys train to land on roads. So we would need a road that's 2,000 feet long, 30 feet wide, relatively straight, with maintained shoulders about 6 or 8 feet on either side. And so that activity would happen mostly at night for about 2 hours. There would be flagmen at either end of the road to make sure that it was safe before the aircraft entered the area. If the aircraft was on approach or on the ground, the flagmen would stop any traffic. The aircraft would take off. The flagmen would give way. Whoever needed to use the force at that time could use it. And if they needed to park right there, then the aircraft would leave. So that's what it looks like for aircraft training. We're looking at using openings in the forest. And in Tatesville specifically, these are all existing helicopter landing zones. So we want to use our helicopters in areas where the Florida Forest uses their helicopters. Our helicopters are a little bit different. We have different variants, as well as we're studying the use of CV-22s. Those are rotary wing aircraft where the rotors turn this way where it takes off, and they turn forward like an airplane when it flies. So it can fly faster than the helicopter, but it lands vertical. And we're looking at using those on a weekly basis. That we would use those to either insert people, up to 50 people. We would look to use those to do parachute drops. So there would be people on the ground watching, making sure that the area was safe. People or a bundle of equipment would come out of an aircraft and float down into the opening. As well, on a quarterly basis or a monthly basis, there may be tents around the helicopter landing zones with up to 50 people. And we're studying right now the use of blank ammunition. I'm sorry, what?
Did you say weekly?
Yes, at some point. So that's the activity around helicopter landing zones. As well, we're looking at using the roads with vehicles. This would be the drive from here to Eglin Air Force Base is a little bit far. So this would probably be on a monthly basis. The activity on the roads would just be a group of vehicles driving through the forest up to 10, as well as the kind of activity I've described before with a group of vehicles either trying to find another group of vehicles or stay away from another group of vehicles while they're under control of the aircraft at about 20,000 feet. As well, we're also studying the use of blackout driving. And what that looks like is at night, there's little cat eyes in the front of the vehicles. The operators would have nods, and they would be practicing driving with only the cat eye lights on at night. So they would not have headlights on. As far as off-road activities, that would be predominantly foot activities from 10 to 12 people, rarely up to 72 people at a time. The Special Forces guys don't get in that large of a bunch very often. They also would be doing some survival training where they would be consuming natural resources. They'd be prohibited from killing anything. I know after I give you the list, you're kind of going to wonder what they're eating, but it's not a lot. So they have to go out there and subsist. Teams of up to two people, up to 10 teams, and that would last for about 7 days. So that activity, if you see them, they're not doing the right thing, and they would be very happy for a candy bar. As well, we're also considering using communications and surveillance equipment, and what that looks like is a group of tents with generators and antennas. Up to 72 people in the vehicles to get them in and out. But that activity is not off-road. I don't think there are any lakes or rivers here that we could use.
You're using
two. So for the lakes and rivers, we're studying the use of overwater hoist operations. What that means is helicopter would hover, either drop a boat or pick people up, and that's the training activity, is to get folks in and out of the helicopter over the top of the water. And then we don't have any force-on-force training here, but we are studying the use of blanks, ground burst simulators, and M18 smoke grenades. in the forest. So some of the things that we're looking at as far as either avoidance areas that are as part of the action is we would avoid inhabited recreation sites, so any campsites, sensitive species areas. We've got detailed maps from the Florida Natural Areas Inventory, as well as the Florida Forest Service's own data. Any inhabited areas, out parcels, as well as adjacent inhabited structures. Culturally significant sites, but we're going to state historic preservation officer right now to determine where those are. And then as well, one of the early stipulations that we realized from the Florida Forest Service is that we would not be able to conduct any activities between 2 hours before sunrise to 2 hours after sunset during hunting season. So those are some of the general stipulations that we've in place on ourselves, or we're looking for studying at this time. So,
could you repeat what you just said?
Sorry, okay, so.
About the activities 2 hours before what do you say?
Okay, so just as a clarification, so during hunting season, there would be no activities.
Well, excuse me, which hunting season?
Okay, so we're still working on that. that's a little bit about what we're doing. That's what we're considering, and my screen's gone away. As well, that's a little bit about the process we're going through, where we are with that. So I'll turn it over to Mr. Carroll.
Good evening. And as Ken said earlier, appreciate all you being here. Jim Carls, I'm the director for the Florida Forest Service. And we manage 1,200,000 acres of land around the state. 35 state forests. We've done it for almost 80 years. I mean, we love this land. A little bit like you guys do. Last night, in Blackwater, we showed a picture of when we got that place and what it looks like today. And just the incredible difference over about a 65 or 70 year process. And we're not going anywhere back to where we started. A lot of what you just heard is the military's envision of what, if they could do what they would like to do, doesn't mean that's what will get approved. All that's looked at, nothing has been approved up to this point. We manage our forest, what we call multiple use concept. And that's why, probably why you're here today, because we open one of our real bases for managing public lands is open it to the people of the state. Give you the opportunity to use it, whether it's hiking, whether it's horseback riding, whether it's hunting or fishing. I'm a big hunter, I'm a big fisher, and I've fished this area for 25 years. And I really feel that those are a big part. Public access is a big part of what we do. Our lands also work for the state in the way of working forest and provide forest products. But at the same time, we burn the land, we manage endangered species, we protect the land within the forest to increase the wildlife. We do a lot of the things that help working in concert with FWC to make that land better, to make it better for the hunters, the fishermen, the hikers, the bird watchers, all of that. And that's where we're going to continue. We're not going to change anything in that way. The military use is part of the multiple use concept. It's another thing, another use on the forest. Could be like the ATV use. Or anything that I said, the hiking, the fishing, the hunting, having apiaries out there, whatever it may be. But it's looked at. It's looked at very closely. We're not even close to looking at it right now. The stuff that was just brought up, they have to get that approved through their NEPA process. If and when that gets done, they come talk to us about it. We have approved, at this time, we have not approved anything
and it'll all be looked at. The hunting part of it will be very important. Which season? And my feeling is all season. I'm a turkey hunter. I don't want that messed up. Now, how do we manage all that within that? How do we look at health in the military? It's like it's very important that we do that. The economy of this part of this state. The military is huge. And just from the standpoint of us as citizens. Now, do we do it at the detriment of our forest, of our natural resources, or our users that are there now? Absolutely not. I have no plans to go there in any way, shape, or form. I'll give you the four criteria that we'll look at. Once Air Force finishes their NEPA and whatever comes out of that, then they come to us. Because as of right today, there is no agreement. There is nothing that says we're going to do any one of the things they said. Now, that's what they are working to get approved so they can ask us. They can't even ask us unless they get that approved. So they have to work to see what they can approve, and then it gives them an opportunity to come to the state and talk about the issues. So these are the criteria that we'll look at once they finish their NEPA process. And the first, in no order, is no impact to the forest resources, to the environment. Sometimes some people say, how do you say no impact? And it might be minimal, but when I look at it, it's no impact. It's no more impact than if a hiker's out there or if a hunter's out there or a fisherman's out there. I don't consider them impacting the forest. And that's what we will hold the military to. They will use the same roads. They will not go off-road. They will not go off heavy equipment. They'll not do things that impact the forest detrimental to the environment. No impact to the forest users. And I think that's everybody in this room. Whether you're hunting, whether you're hiking, whether you're bird watching, whether you're fishing. I don't want to be on the river fishing and have a helicopter hovering over my head. So what we will do is we will look at all of that. And we'll walk very slow with this thing. If we look at stuff in the future, it will be a very, very slow process. Because what I don't want you coming and giving me heck for something we've done. I want you to enjoy the use of your forest. I want all of those opportunities to continue. And if we can mix the military in to some degree, that's what we're looking at here. But we're looking at no impact to the users. No impact to the adjacent landowners. If there's in holdings or on the edges of the forest, adjacent landowners, we don't want no impact to them. So all that is looked at. And then the last thing is we have a 10-year state forest resource management plan that we have to follow. And that guides how we manage this piece of property. And any military use that may come to the future has to follow that management plan. The management plan is approved through ARC and through the Board of Trustees, and their military action will have to follow that management plan. And that's a pretty strict management plan, what you do. So those four criteria is how we will look at this thing once they finish their NEPA process. So from that standpoint, to really look at is we're waiting. We're listening. We're listening to you, and we're listening to the military. Nobody is saying to me right now, you have to do this. So we're going to take it into consideration. But my whole basis is I don't want to impact the resources here, and I don't want the people upset that use this forest. So what we will be looking at is that no impact in? Just emphasizing that, we've been managing land a long time. These guys, this place means a lot to them as well. They put their heart and soul in it, and they don't want it. They don't want anything detrimental to it either. And we're all in that together. We're with you on that.
And we will look at it. We'll take into consideration once they finish their NEPA. And then we will have more discussion. Because whatever we finish, we will talk to the ARC. We will meet with you. We'll have this discussion, this open discussion. When and if we get to that point. But we're not there now. But we're getting the input now, and that's what's important. With that, I'll finish up, and I think there's an opportunity to open questions, Kate.
Yes. Commissioner Sanders, since you were partly to take credit for getting the group together, I would like to give you the opportunity to address the crowd if you would like to. If not, it's up to you.
If you don't mind, Ken, I would rather defer at this time.
Okay.
I would like to hear some of the public comments.
And we do have 11 people that signed up to speak on the 3:12. So that's about an hour of sitting. If you want to take a 5-minute break, stretch, let's do that. And I'll call you back in order. And when the time stops, the red card will come out. And we'll start off with Mark Nobles.
Talk to everybody. I'm the manager of the Caravel Airport, and as much as I'm a hunter and a fisherman, my concerns are not as much with the land use as the air use above it. The Air Force uses a lot of acronyms for different agencies, different parts, and such, and for years and years and years, there's not been any radar service area in this area for looking at aircraft down low. Now they've got Southeast Air Defense Systems that handles aircraft that may be coming from foreign countries or what else to come into the areas for part of the air defense infiltration zone, I think they call it. And it can see from the surface unlimited. And I've been intercepted offshore several times at low altitude just to verify or qualify that. In this area, I probably got over 5,000 hours at low-level law enforcement flying for marine resources and environmental protection with the state of Florida. Beyond that, I've got another 6,000 hours of just a flying period. But I've been intercepted offshore as low as 200 feet. And right here at Caravel, I've been told we can't give you radar services because our radars will not see below 1,500, 2,000 feet, somewhere in that vicinity. Well, that's because that's RAPCOM. That's Radar Approach Control. They sit in the same room with one another, but don't communicate. So they don't offer the services to general aviation for radar vectoring to avoid conflict with other aircraft and inclement conditions, weather conditions, in this entire region. And you're going to be dropping somebody's children from helicopters. The only way you can do that is to put in restricted airspace. That restricted airspace may be active only during the training times that are already set up. But I've seen situations with Eglin where it was active but not used, where general aviation was forced to make a decision of I either go into it or I die, because you've got to get through that restricted airspace to circumnavigate bad weather. Back in 1999, well, put it this way, this needs a lot more discussion than 30 more seconds when it comes to the problems we've got with airspace, and I would love to talk to you more about that.
Okay, I'd love to talk to you about that afterwards. Real quickly, just to let you know, this particular landscape initiative has no airspace. We're not creating any airspace. There's not any kind of airspace actions associated with this. There are, I can talk to you about the overall GRASI thing. There are some things with that that are being created and some new procedures and some stuff like that I can talk to you about offline if you want.
So. Okay.
Okay. Sure.
I don't mean no harm by this, but this is a meeting to answer questions, And Mark has got a very important issue here, and I think it takes more than what y'all allow in time. I don't care if I'm here until midnight.
I'll give you 5 minutes.
I won't listen to the people and their opinion. And if it takes Mark 5 minutes to say it, and I don't mean no harm by it, but y'all said y'all called this meeting, called Cheryl. Well, Cheryl won't hear people. Okay? And that's, I mean, I want to hear what Mark's got to say, because this has never been brought up about the civil, you know, the civil airspace and all this. This is a very important point that I feel like needs to be said. And if I'm wrong, y'all tell me. But I think that we're here to listen to the people and their opinions and their concerns. And if you don't let them talk, you still going to suppress their voices.
We're going to come. Mark, finish up.
We're just trying to get off.
If we had 100, we wouldn't be able to get everything.
I understand. And I'll give up my time if y'all run over. I'm not worried about that. I want to listen to the people.
Okay, but anyhow, the airspace, I don't know how you can drop my child from a helicopter, aircraft of any sort, when anybody can fly through that airspace. Right now, this is all part of a MOA, a military operations area, and all that says is that other pilots need to be aware that there may be military aircraft operating in that area. But when you don't have radar services to avoid collisions and such, it's so simple for an incident like Fort Bragg, North Carolina, where the paratroopers jumped out. That's their own people with radar that ran through and killed, I don't know how many soldiers it was that were doing training exercises. This area, during the spring, when the big air show is going on in Lakeland, there's thousands of aircraft that fly back and forth through here. I was working one day, and we call it scud running when you're below 200 feet. And I was scud running under some bad weather, thinking, well, I'm the only one out here. Landed at Apalachicola while I was refueling, sitting there. Four more airplanes came in that weren't talking to anyone, that were up in the clouds. Perfect opportunity. Now, I know you can't operate like that in that type of environment. You don't do your training then. But if they activate that area, if they make a restricted airspace area, then the only way you can protect those troops is to have such. And once it becomes active, no aircraft can come through that area. I mean, it's off limits. But if there's no training going on and someone happened to activate that area and someone needs to go through that area, they can't. As a matter of fact, in 1999, there was a situation just out of Crestview, where one aircraft was headed east, one was headed west. The one headed east was asking for permission to go into some restricted airspace that was denied, or told he could not authorize that transition to get around thunderstorms. There was a squall line going across. I mean, it was you can't go anywhere. That's the only place left you could go. The one coming west was not allowed to go down into it. And the one going east went through it, went to Panama City. The one going west went through the thunderstorm, tore both wings off, killed both souls on board. I doubt very seriously there was any training going on in that type of weather environment, but it was restricted. It was active. Mm-hmm. And it went down as pilot error because he flew through a thunderstorm. Mm-hmm. Unless radar services are enhanced, and that's a major operation. Communication services are enhanced, another major operator. There's a whole lot of work before just using the floor, just using the forest. We'd have a lot of traffic that comes through from up north, that comes into Apalachicola, comes into Caravelle, that can't get in, you know, other than come straight in. If they have to circle and come all the way around, they may have to look at other options for fueling along the way and such. There's more to it than just the forest itself. The airspace above it's important to us. I'd like for you to take all the considerations you can on that.
And I appreciate that. And actually, that's how this whole thing started back in 2006. GRASI was actually the Gulf Regional Airspace Strategic Initiative, because we recognized the fact that, first of all, as you know, this is very complex airspace above Northwest Florida, very complex. It's very tough to get in and out of, as you know. So one of the things we did with the GRASI thing was try to figure out what our, as we add all these missions, what does that do to the airspace? And what we found was, as we were adding all these things and doing all these things, a lot of the airspace thing was being complicated because of the activity on the ground. So one of the reasons we're looking at this landscape thing is to kind of spread some of that stuff off the ground to help alleviate some of the congestion in the restricted area. Now this particular thing with the landscape does not include any creation of restricted airspace. Guys who would be dropped and those kinds of things that would require restricted airspace will happen in restricted airspace that's already there, that is over the edge of the range. The other stuff that would occur in these particular areas we're talking about are not, they don't require restricted airspace.
Well, I know a lot of this has been going on for years anyhow. You know, the Osprey has been flying and it's fun watching it. Right. There's no doubt about that. But when you start mixing that with troops and operations and that sort of thing, my biggest thought on it is if you take an aviation sectional and look at the restricted airspace in the panhandle from just the other side of Panama City, because this is all military operations area, the only restricted airspace is right off of Tyndall where they fire the drones. But west of Panama City, all the way through the Alabama line, is paid up with restricted airspace. Blackwater is pretty much restricted airspace and used to restricted airspace. I mean, you just about got to be talking to somebody traveling over that way anyhow.
You're right, it's very, very busy.
Yeah,
very,
and, busy. And it is, it's a busy area. This gets kind of busy too, and the unfortunate side of it is the military, when they're doing their training operations and a VFR aircraft comes through, they have to pick up their toys and move elsewhere. It costs the government quite a bit of money to do that. I understand that. But if you're going to increase activities that's going to utilize airspace, increase those activities where the airspace is already.
Gotcha. And just so you know, the activities we're talking about in these forest areas, VFR, it's single engine VFR traffic. These guys are not doing the other kind of stuff that would happen in the Eglin Range. That's the kind of stuff that we're having to do on the Eglin Range. What we're trying to do is find areas for those other guys who don't need to do that stuff in restricted airspace. And you're right, restricted airspace is very big over Eglin, very complex, and it's tough getting there and out. And that's, it really was the birth of GRASI. The first GRASI thing was because of the airspace issue. So.
I have a quick question,
just
based
on
that. So are you going to need restricted airspace,
no.
Or are you not? So no restricted airspace.
There's no plan.
So
first of all,
so either airport will still get the amount of air traffic that's going on there.
Yes.
It was mentioned earlier, use of a CV-22 Osprey. Mm-hmm. Is that a single engine plane?
No.
No, it's not.
No.
No. So your statement is wrong.
Well, the stuff he was talking about is different than the CV-22s. What he's talking about was guys. We don't typically drop guys. They will land typically. CV-22s will land, let the guys
right.
get out.
Right.
Pick them up, those kind of things.
But that aircraft will be operating in that airspace, correct?
Yes. VFR. All right, everybody who's going to be operating is going to be VFR, visual flight rules, just like any other general aviation aircraft.
All right, next speaker, Buddy.
We're speaking generalities here regarding drop zones and whatnot. You know, you were saying you can stay so far away from campsites. Now you're talking about flying over a river. What river? What river are we talking that you're going to be contemplating dropping guys off on?
Right, so we're looking at all the bodies of water. That's what we're studying at this point.
So you haven't gotten any specifics where you can actually come here with a map and say, here are the areas that we're interested in? Because right now you're talking a pretty big area.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, no, I understand.
It's bounded by 65, Highway 67, and Highway 98, correct?
Well,
roughly?
Well, it's Tate State Forest.
Right.
So, at this point, no, we don't have any specifics for you. That's what the draft environmental impact statement is for.
Mm-hmm.
When that is published, there'll be very detailed maps on what we're looking at.
And
as well,
hearings regarding these areas?
That's correct.
Okay, so
that's
right now, if you're going to be dropping a guy off, or peoples off in a river, I just can't see how you're going to, block the river off on a certain time?
No. What would happen, that's dropping people off basically over in lakes. So that would, the river's okay. A little bit small for that.
All right. Well, you did say river, so I was just asking.
Right. I understand. Thanks for your question.
So no river? You wouldn't be...
Again, if it's wide enough, we would consider it.
Okay. And those specifics are, again, coming later.
Right. So part of your question, though, is how do we make sure what we're doing is safe wherever we do it?
Well, right, and how are you going to notify people that you're doing it?
Right. But part of this is, and I know this may be marginally satisfactory at this point, is the first thing we're going to look at is environmental impact. And part of that is how we would make it safe. So that would be in the draft EIS. Once we've worked that out and see if it is feasible, part of the conversation with the Florida Forest Service is, okay, how do we coordinate those activities? And how do we then coordinate between us and them on when and where we would do that? Okay. So those details are yet to be worked out. Okay. But what I can tell you is the way we do it now is there are ground parties that inspect the area to make sure that there's nobody else using that area. Mm-hmm. And then those activities are conducted. And there are ground parties that look out to make sure that nobody else wants to use that area during the activity. And so that's how we make it safe.
Okay, and environmental is it's noise?
Environmental is noise, air quality, water quality. They look at embarkments and disembarkment points as far as wetlands, soils. We would look at avoiding invasive species because we don't want to, you know, the reason a species is invasive is it attaches to something or someone and is carried to another place. So we would avoid those areas. We'd avoid culturally significant areas. A lot of those are in the lowlands. So there's a myriad of environmental factors that we're studying at this point. So that's kind of our first wicket.
Okay.
And then once we get through that,
More specific.
Right.
And then we'll have more comments.
When we publish the draft, we'll have another hearing, okay. And it won't be question and answer like this, but it'll be, okay, you've had the draft for 45 days, please give us your comments on that. We'll take those comments away, incorporate them into the final, have more comment period, but there won't be a meeting during that time, but you'll be able to submit comments on the final, and then a decision will be made about what we will approach the Florida Forest Service with.
So you think there'll be one more open meeting? With specifics, map, et cetera?
Yes.
Okay.
So the document will be large, and there will be a lot of specifics in there. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks for your question. Yes, ma'am.
When you said you wanted to avoid invasive species, did you mean endangered species?
No. No.
You're going to avoid invasive species. Why? Because you're afraid of transporting?
Right. So invasive species are... I don't mean to insult anybody's intelligence, but endangered species are those species that are natural to the area that for whatever reason are not doing well. So they're at risk of being extinct. Invasive species are species that are not natural to the area that are taking over. So kudzu, that's invasive. It takes over. Red-cockaded woodpecker, that's endangered. It was here and is not doing well. So there's a lot of management practices to recover that. So both of those areas we would avoid, one for the reason that we don't want to impact the species, the other because we don't want to spread the species.
I'm going to sneak up behind you just a minute. During their scoping process, the military has very strict federal regulations they have to follow in the scoping process. We're the state. We don't have to follow those. So when they're having their scoping meeting, that does not preclude us from having a meeting just like we're having right now. It doesn't preclude us from putting maps out that we can show you, that we can discuss, that we can get your input. And that's why we're here. One of the reasons we're here tonight is because what happened originally with the initial scoping meeting, you didn't have a chance to put your input in. So the Forest Service is going to be here. The Forest Service is going to be answering your questions. And it'll kind of be a follow-up. It could be just prior to them getting the final report. It could be just after they get it. But whatever you're hearing when you come here to their meeting, we can have a follow-up meeting and actually provide you answers and provide a forum just like this. So that would be over and above the process. So there will be more meetings. Will be more maps, and there will be more detail. And we'll have more meetings.
All right, next speaker, Betty Cummins.
Here. I have a few things up and not much time. You're talking about the landing on the roads. You were describing the landings. Any of these activities, This are training activities, which means that these are inexperienced people. And I do not believe that it's possible for Eglin to guarantee that the state forest will be protected from accidental damage, because the proposal includes the use of airplanes, helicopters, Humvee-type vehicles, and that's a very fragile environment. In 2004, a U.S. Air Force plane crashed into a marsh on St. George Island. You're probably well aware of that. And Franklin County does not need any more accidental damage to fragile wetlands or other irreplaceable habitat, especially as a result of training by inexperienced personnel. I believe that one was with somebody who was experienced. The other thing is somewhere in all of the stuff I've read, there was a timeline on one of the things that were posted online. And at the very end, it said that the final decision on this was being made by the Pentagon. Well, here you're telling me that the final decision is by the U.S. Forest Service. Now, which is it?
It's not the Pentagon.
Well,
real clear right here.
Okay.
The Pentagon, from the standpoint of this environmental assessment, and what they can do, what they can ask us to do, will be their decision. When they complete that, they'll come and they might ask us, can we do this kind of training? And after these meetings, we say, no, you can do these two, but you can't do these eight.
No.
And that decision is ours. If we say, no, no to this, no to this, no to this, that will be our decision. We may say, yes, these three have no impact. The Pentagon will make the decision on what they can come to ask us. We will make the decision on what will happen.
The consequences of the decision has no impact on you personally as human beings. You and your families are not impacted as far as what happens here to the people that live in this community from what you're proposing. What I'm hearing from you, John, it sounds good, and I think your heart's in the right place. However, there are other people that are part of this decision-making process by the Forestry Service, and there is an annual fee, at least from what was posted, of $382,000 being paid to the Forestry Service.
That document that you have is a draft document that was produced by action level officer folks who are trying to come up with a framework that has not even come to the Pentagon. We have not even seen it. When it was being read the other night, it was the first time I'd ever even heard it. So that those were figures that somebody at a low level has just kind of thrown out there as a draft number. We have not signed up to anything. The Forest Service has not asked us for anything. No money has been talked about, except at the lower levels.
But are you able to tell me that there will be no profit to anyone from this? It certainly isn't going to be to the people of Franklin County in terms of job or economic benefits. There's nothing like that for us.
If there's any funding in it, if any funding changes hands, what we will have to do, if we do anything, we'll have people monitoring it. Somebody will essentially be dealing with it that will say, okay, it's going to cost us this much over and above what we do already. And we may say, we're only going to do these four projects, whatever, and it'll cost us $20,000, it'll cost us $50,000, or whatever that decision might be. What we're looking at is, at a minimum, is being able to cover cost to make sure that we can monitor it very well, because we're not going to do it and say, go do your thing and walk away from it. We're going to monitor it very close, and if we're going to put people into it, if we got somebody doing that and it cost us, we're going to say to the military, you got to pay our cost to do that. But we're not going to leave it wide open not to. So we're going to have somebody tied into this. And yes, eventually, if we say we're going to do this, we're going to say it's going to cost you this much, because it will cost us something to make sure we monitor it correctly. And those, if anything, those are the figures that you'll see eventually that will that would be transpired from the military to the Florida Forest Service. We don't know what that is right now, because we don't know. We have I have not said yes to anything except to talk. And that's what we're doing tonight.
Is that all going to be transparent?
It'll be transparent.
Whatever the money...
That'll all be part of lease agreements or permits or those kinds of things.
I don't know what it will take. I mean, you've got a lot of people, and there has... obviously, you see where most of the citizens here, how we feel about it. For me, and I think most of us here, the only acceptable decision is the no-action alternative for Tate's health. And I don't know how we separate ourselves from what you're considering for Blackwater River. I know there are two different situations, two different proximities. But I would like for you to please consider that if you don't need Tate's help, you really don't need Tate's help, you just want Tate's help, but you don't need it, then please don't take it.
So let me just, thanks for your comment. It was a great comment, and I understand. A couple of things. One is you talked about training, and there's a difference between proficiency training and educational training. So these are not inexperienced pilots. They're not learning how to fly the aircraft. Even the NFL goes to practice every day. So that's what we're talking about, is Air Force Special Operations pilots that do have a lot of experience flying their aircraft, rehearsing what they have to do for their jobs. So, just as a point of reference.
In terms of the traffic,
accidents happen.
But I understand.
What do you do? Just say, "Oh, we're sorry."
Right, and put a fence around it.
Okay, so and your point about that we don't have a stake in what happens here. You know what you do in the state forest. Me and my family do at Eglin Air Force Base. We swim, we hike, we do bird watching, we go out there for recreation. So I understand your perspective, but there are those activities that we do at the Eglin Air Force Base in amongst all the other things that go on there that makes me feel comfortable and looking at this here. So I understand your perspective, and thank you. That was a great comment. And I just wanted to let you know those few things that related to your points. So.
All right, Marilyn Hogan.
I'll be very brief. I'm having a problem with credibility. I was here for the first meeting, and I remember the gentleman standing here and saying, if y'all don't want us, we'll go away. And I'm also remembering that you said if you contact us through our website, we'll keep you posted on what's happening. I never got an email saying that there's going to be a meeting today. I did see it in the newspaper. Thank you very much. And I have written to environmental agencies, and I have not heard anything about any comments from any environmental agencies. Has the National Wildlife Organization, has the Department of Interior involved in this? Who's involved in it? I wrote to Governor Scott, and I got a response. Well, I've had interaction. My latest response was on Monday, the 9th of December. Quote, the governor has not given any endorsement other than the proper usage of state land. To be clear, the land cannot be used for more than what it is used for at present. Signed, Warren Davis, Office of Citizen Services, Executive Office of the Governor. Which way is it? I mean, you're saying that you want our opinions, you want input, but do you really?
We do. And that's why we're here. I will tell you, this particular meeting is over and above what we're required to do. I mean, this we came and offered to do this because it was, I know it was frustrating last time, not to be able to have that give and take. And it is, you know, unfortunately, the way the NEPA system is set up, we're required to take input so that we have a legal, so we can go back and have a record and all those kinds of things. And it doesn't lend itself to that give and take. So that's why we want to come back and give this give and take.
Why do I feel like I'm sitting in a room where a decision has already been made?
I would hope you not feel that way, because I can guarantee you a decision has not been made, because we cannot even approach the Forest Service with actually what we want to do until we get finished with this environmental process. This environmental process gets us to the point where we have a set of alternatives that are hopefully very well determined and very well thought out and have been analyzed. And we can talk to the impacts of species and recreation and all those different things. We will then take that, and the record of decision that you talked about a minute ago is the record of decision from us, the Air Force, for my leadership, to say, okay, you guys, you've done all this, now go talk to the Forest Service and see what they say.
What about environmental agencies? Where do they enter into that?
We've had folks...
So, at the beginning of the environmental planning process, we send out letters that are called HICEP letters, I-I-C-E-P. It's Intergovernmental Interagency Coordination for Environmental Planning. We send those letters to all of our agencies that regulate our activities. We send them to the EPA, the Fish and Wildlife Service, the State Historic Preservation Officer, all those government agencies, and we notify them that we're entering this process. We send them all the documents. They comment on all the documents. Not only are we subject to the National Environmental Policy Act, we're subject to the Endangered Species Act, National Historic Preservation Act, Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act. So all these regulatory agencies look at what we're doing and determine whether or not, under their own jurisdiction, how we should do those and how we fit into the law on protecting those resources. At the end of this, and we go through that for each one of these steps, and we're currently in conversations with the Fish and Wildlife Service on endangered species, we're in conversations with the State Historic Preservation Officer on cultural resources. We're not in conversation with NIMS or anybody offshore because nothing we're considering goes offshore at this point. At the end of all of these conversations, the agencies that regulate us, as well as the state agencies, Fish and Wildlife, and the State Historic Preservation Officer, I've mentioned several times already, but we send our document to the EPA, and they look at it for sufficiency and determine whether or not the document sufficiently describes what a potential environmental impacts may be before we take this action. So there is a lot of other agencies involved. At this point, we're looking for your comments back to us, and those will be recorded, but not in this meeting because it's not the scoping meetings or hearings. Those will be recorded and put in the document as things that we are considering. So I hope that answers your question.
Does the U.S. Fish and Wildlife one of those agencies?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
Guy Hogan?
Yes, sir. Most of my questions have been answered for these other folks, but I do, in order to have those planes, you're going to have to put up some towers, right? Communication. Aren't you going to have to install towers for communication for these aircraft? As I remember in last August, that you said that they were going to put up something to transmit their radio frequencies or their...
It's a little bit confusing, I understand, it's a good question. So for the activities that we're considering for light aircraft, helicopters, and CV-22s, we don't need any additional towers. Those will all be, as this gentleman said earlier, those will all be visual flight rules. So that's all the way the FAA controls the airspace is when pilots take off, they can either file an instrument flight plan or have visual flight rules. And visual flight rules means every pilot is responsible for not running into something else. So that's the way they'll be operating. So we do not need any additional instrumentation to fly those aircraft. Now, what you're thinking about is a separate part of this where to use the airspace that we currently have out over the Gulf, as well as the MOA that was previously, and the restricted airspace that was previously discussed, we are considering moving instrumentation packages around through 12 fixed sites. So these would move around, and these instrumentation packages would replicate, the best way to say it is enemy radar, or enemy air defenses. And the purpose of those would be to give the F-35 guys that are headed towards the range that we already use from the Gulf, replicate what they would see if they were to have to do their job somewhere besides the United States.
And then this would be a mobile radar type of
Something
that you could move around a trailer. It wouldn't necessitate anything.
On a flatbed truck, some of them are like a truck, some of them are a trailer.
I see. Right.
So we would have 12 sites. We move them around. That way the guys in the cockpits don't get the same look every time. Because to use the football analogy again, it would be like running your offense against the same defense every time. So we want to give them a good scrimmage, and that's the objective. So many of those sites are not in state forest. They're on state forest lands, but they are previously used fire towers that were going to be excess that we may be able to use.
And they would be all over Northwest Florida. This thing is not confined to Tate Hill. It's just those little mobile sites that might be over in the Scambia or Santa Rosa
And the way they would be used is the aircraft would start at about 30,000 feet, about 60 miles offshore, would head towards onshore. It's a stealth aircraft, so if you see it or hear it, they're not doing their jobs. Would come down at about 20,000 feet to look for those radars, essentially doing electronic things inside the cockpit. The aircraft would identify those things. The guys would rehearse responding to that, climb back up to an altitude, and rehearse looking for targets north of here. So all that happens above 20,000 feet.
It just seems strange to me that the Air Force can't find some place that's not as a forest that is as temperamental as our Tate's Hill. I mean, you know, there's so many other areas that are available, I'm sure, rather than take a forest like we've got here that just doesn't seem logical. I mean, it seems to me that, and I'm sure a lot of these other people, that it would be much better to find, it's possible to find another available site. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next speaker, James Chambuna.
Chambers.
Okay.
And he put a little answer to both of my questions, but comment from me does that the taxpayers in this area pay for this land. These public lands are bought with taxpayer money for the public. And I know the state of Florida bought it from by the state of Florida, and they got their rules and all this kind of thing. But the Air Force also gets tax dollars to buy property for their training and their personnel, their buildings and whatever they do to run the airport. Now, I'm not against military at all. I like the military. I really do. But to come in here and say that the military doesn't have anywhere else but Tate's Hill to go and do this training, it's not right. I know it costs you more to do this training in other areas, and you talk about travel time and all this kind of stuff, but that's part of the military. That's their problem. The military bought their properties where they bought them. They got giant pieces of property all over. Not in this area especially, but they do have giant pieces of property. I've been on the properties up at Fort Benning for a few months. I've been on the properties over at Pensacola. It's great. I've been on the properties over here at Tyndall where y'all train at. But to me, it doesn't seem right to say you want to use public property bought with public money when the military gets the money to do the same thing. If y'all bought your property in the wrong place, y'all should do something about it. One way or the other. That would get my feelings on the whole thing.
Can I respond to that real quick? So if I could just expound a little bit, you know, one of the things we want to do with this is we're trying to create flexibility. Because we have all these different missions coming in.
I understand that, but we want our flexibility.
Exactly. And so what this process is doing is allow us to see if there is possibility for flexibility here. If there's not, then
the thing about it is, y'all have the opportunity to spend your money wisely.
Right.
To stay there.
Right. Totally got it, and you're right. So what we're looking at as planners is, if we don't have the flexibility to do some of these kind of missions here or in Blackwater or wherever, then we have to start looking and see, okay, where else can we do it? Where else can we do it? You know, maybe we need to move some missions, maybe we need to do some other things. So that's what this process is allowing us to do to be able to determine whether or not we have the needed flexibility.
Well, I know the military gets adequate funding to do what they need to do. I believe that totally.
Okay.
Along with a lot of other people. Without coming in and interfering with public land.
Right.
Public land was not bought for the military.
Right, and I totally agree. And we're looking to see if there is compatibility. If there's not compatibility, if we find there's not compatibility,
well, it looks like you would know that going in.
Okay. This is my job. So if the Forest Service tells us it's not going to work, then we have to go look other places to fix it.
Leslie Cox.
My name is Leslie Cox. I'm president of the Florida Green Guide Association. So I'm speaking on behalf of the association. And we are a trade organization whose members have received 90 hours of training at the Wakulla Environmental Institute to become nature-based business owners. And that institute was started in 2006, so we've successively been graduating people out of that program. And there's several business owners, fellow Green Guides in here tonight, because Tate State Forest is one of the areas that we have been trying to showcase for Franklin County. We're trying to get a nature-based tourism opportunities for the county. We're trying to bring people from all over the world. I have a map here that shows hot spots. That's the hot spots in red of threatened and species of special concern. These are just the plant species. This map doesn't even show the animal species. I've taken out groups from the American Butterfly Association into Tatesale because there's so many butterflies out there that there's actually dozens of people that come here to just look at the butterflies. There's people that come to look at the carnivorous plants. There's people that come to look at the birds. Swallowtail kites nest in Tatesale. Bald eagles nest in Tatesale. It's unbelievable the diversity that we have on this 200,000 acre site of public lands. Like the gentleman before me said, it was bought with public money. It was bought for multiple uses, managed by the state of Florida, Florida Forest Service, that we believe, as the association, that this is an incompatible use. It's not in the, there's no military use in the current management plan. So we feel very strongly that it's just not a compatible use. Thank you.
We have a written statement
from
the association.
Thank you. Michael, work out.
Tate's Hell State Forest, it's a natural watershed. And it's one that protects a fragile existing ecosystem. It also acts as a filter for all the runoff into the Apalachicola Bay. The bay has enough problems as it is now. Hydrocarbons coming out of these vehicles going into the bay, it's not going to work. And without obvious intention, the kind of activities proposed by the Air Force would add a lot more problems than they would solve for the state forestry system. If you think that all the avgas is consumed by the aircraft, stand next to one when it's running and use your nose. You'll smell what isn't being burnt and what is going into the air and onto the ground, and then into the water system, and then into the bay. It is an existing problem. We don't need any more of it. The current state of government may think it's a financial windfall,
but future generations will pay the price to clean up the mess that we leave. I have a couple of questions also. That's just my basic statement. This memorandum of agreement, is this an action agreement or just a document to...
I like to call this an agreement to agree. It was basically an agreement between us and the state of Florida that basically I could go back to my boss and say the state is willing to talk to us. That was really what the memorandum around.
So it's not divine. It's not saying that anybody can go and do something.
No.
I signed it. Commissioner Baggett Colfer signed it, Mayor Colfer signed. And what it says is we'll talk.
Were you directed by the governor to do this?
I was not directed. No. I don't work for the governor.
Sweet. I would like to bring something else up. It talks about identifying options for compensation for the Air Force's use of Tate's Hill. And this document is a year old, a little better than a year old. Have any of those options been discussed?
I think somebody brought up some dollar figures earlier.
Right.
And as they looked at that initial stuff, they talked about what it would cost us to monitor the stuff. We don't know yet because until they complete their NEPA, we won't even know what they
have. Until they come to you and tell you what they want to do?
And then what we decide. Right. And then if we decide anything, then we decide what it costs us. Yeah. We're not going to do it for free. We're going to say, you got to compensate so that we can make this work in the right way. If that happens at all, it may not happen at all. We don't know. But there's no dollar figures now. And no dollar figures changing hands now.
Does the EIS consider noise pollution as one of the pollutants that would be created?
The EIS will analyze it. Some of the other things you mentioned, the EIS will analyze water quality, air quality, noise.
Are they going to do baselines before operations start?
I think what the modeling looks like now is looking at noise-sensitive areas, providing a buffer
around. Salt sensitive. Go out, live out there, and tell me whether it's sensitive or not.
Okay.
You understand where I'm coming from?
I do.
Talk to a red-cockaded woodpecker and ask him if noise is a pollutant for his son. That's where he lives.
One of the reasons that we felt comfortable talking about this in Tate's Hill was because of the way we manage natural resources at Eglin. You mentioned the red-cockaded woodpecker. We have met our recovery goals at Eglin for the red-cockaded woodpecker. And we're actually giving away breeding pairs to other places
that
have.
I'm not saying the Air Force is either,
so
don't get me wrong.
So I appreciate that, but you brought it up, so I just wanted to say we're pretty good at that, so
right.
We felt comfortable considering operations and things out.
And one last question.
Sure.
On your way ahead schedule,
yes.
One of your items is a mitigation plan.
Mm-hmm.
What do you plan to have to mitigate?
When we get to the end of this, typically what we would say is, the action that we were originally considering would have this impact. However, if we incorporate this mitigation, we have mitigated that impact. So it could be changing the way we operate, it could be changing the proposal we originally considered, or it could be doing something else.
I'm an old hazmat guy. A mitigation plan is cleaning up a mess.
Well, that's in that context, you're correct.
Right.
But in the NEPA and planning context, mitigation is before you actually conduct the operations.
And considering anything that could occur?
Correct.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. So, yeah, a mitigation plan is different in a hazmat context and in a planning context. So. And, sorry, hazmat is hazardous material.
You said NOMS earlier.
I said what?
You said NOMS earlier, too.
Oh, sorry. I said NODs earlier. NODs are night observation devices. It's goggles that pilots use at night. I'm trying to. It's a little hard to translate. So
when you said I saw a lot of blank stares, so that's
I don't mean to insult anybody. I apologize. I'm just trying to be clear. So we speak in a lot of military ease. So please ask. You know, raise your hand if I say something that
says something.
Okay, next speaker, Bobby Miller. I'm almost at a loss for this squirrel went up there tonight.
Folks, if you love your forest lovers and all, hang on. We have trouble. We got a big, big problem. I've heard we'll only use the roads in the areas that are open to me. And one breath and the next breath, they say they're going to land a helicopter out here in the clear. What I mean? What does all that mean? First of all, I'd like to say I'm in no way against the military at all. And I don't think anyone in this room is against the military. That's just not even an argument. That's not why we're here. A lot of things come to mind. First of all, this area was bought with Carl money. And that stands for conservation and recreational lands. That's what Carl stands for, and that's the money that was used to purchase this property. And we'd like to keep it like that. You know, we have this no net loss of hunting, fishing rights, a forest use law in the state of Florida. Well, they can mitigate that and open up some more land down south and take that forest from us over there. They mentioned that, I think, CV-22, I call them the Raptors, I guess you call them. I call them VTOLs, vertical takeoff and landings. We had one here in the county a month or so ago. Completely shook the pictures off the wall of Boy's house out of the airport. They called the county planner in. They got the thing out of here. If the Air Force moves in here and does what I'm thinking they're going to do, they're going to shatter the nighttime. They're going to shatter the silence. If you walk out here on this porch, you hear nothing. If you want to hear some noise, go to Panama City, Destin, Fort Walton, that area. That's not why we live here. We live here because you can walk out and there are black night skies to look at without any noise pollution, any light pollution, or otherwise. That's why we live here. That's why we go to the trouble to drive to another area to go shopping and do our shopping. We like it like that. And I'm afraid that if FFS lets them go into that property, it's going to be the beginning of the end for us. All I can tell you is to hug a FFS guy the next time you see him, because I think the ball's in their court primarily. What's concerning to me is where the FFS is going to get such a monetary push from the Air Force or the military that they're going to throw us under the bus over this deal.
Yep.
And, you know, I don't know, usually when you dig to the end of something, you get to the final analysis, is a lot of times there's money involved in the thing before it's over, said and done. I don't know. I'm getting mixed feelings about this thing tonight. Last time I spoke at one of these meetings, had a good attorney friend tell me after that meeting, he said, you probably don't want to speak at any more meetings because you're probably going to have federal marshals knocking on your door tomorrow. But, you know, I just hate to see it. Why not do this for us? Why not move this thing north out of the Tate's Hill area? Why is it that every time we try to save something, we gave up a lot to do this, but every time we try to save something, and this is not for us, this is for our children and our grandchildren. That's why the whole thing got started like that. It's, you know, we use it today. But we would like to see one little spot on the face of the earth preserved so they can go look at it 100 years from now and say, you know, this hasn't changed in 100 years. It's just like it used to be. They say there's not going to be any pollution. We've got a jet airplane sitting 50 feet in the ground in the mud out here just this side of the St. George Island. When we were asked to come, well, the Air Force actually came over when we had a plane land on the runway out there. We all ran out into the plane with the fire truck. They said, we need to come talk to you. Don't open this compartment because there's radioactive material in there. Don't open this compartment. I mean, now they're telling us there's not going to be any pollution. How do we know that? How do they know that? They cannot guarantee that. I do not believe that. If they get out of there, if they don't ever put a foot on it, then I can guarantee you it won't be polluted. But if they go in there on that property, it's going to be polluted, period. That's just the bottom line. Sooner or later, it's going to happen. It's just a matter of time. FFS says they don't want them doing any more on that property than we can do. The thing's just not adding up here, though. You put 50 or 60 people at the time out there, 12 or 15 trucks, whatever he said, running over the state forest roads. That thing's used 24/7, 365 days out of the year by somebody in this county or somebody out of this county. This thing's not limited just to this county. This is a prize for us to show off to people from all over the place. And, you know, I just hate to see FFS throw us under the bus over this deal. And it seems like the more of these meetings we have, a little bit more comes out of each meeting, a little bit more leaks out of the cracks. You know, I haven't heard about these VTOLs, and I don't know. Just hope and pray that we can keep it pristine like it is now. Thank you.
Sorry, Zell.
Thank you. Well, I drove all the way over here from Perry, from Taylor County, and I can't agree more with Miss Betty and Leslie and Bobby who just spoke. I totally agree with everything that they said. You talked a little while ago about a timeline. But you didn't tell everybody the whole story of this. You said 2005, I believe, is when y'all started working on this, 2005 or 8. A little bit before that time, the Air Force came over to Taylor County, and they wanted to move the bombing range from Eglin Air Force Base to Taylor County. There were a couple of Lancasters who wanted to take land from Santa Rosa County and trade it for 64,000 acres over in Taylor County, and that was what they talked about first, was that they wanted to make it a bombing range and a missile test site. Well, pretty much people in Taylor County got upset about that, and we said, wait a minute, we don't want a bombing range here. What's in it for us? Nothing. Not a darn thing. And as time wore on, we got into this long, drawn-out battle with the Air Force that lasted about 2 or 3 years, pretty much put our lives on hold there in the county, all of us who were opposing this bad idea, we thought. We finally talked to our county commissioners, after a lot of struggle, into letting us have a non-binding referendum on this issue, whether or not to let the military have the land in Taylor County as a bombing range. 76% of the people there voted against it. So the Air Force immediately said, okay, if you don't want it, it's okay. We won't come. Well, about 3 months after that, Colonel Nolan over at the Air Force Base came back again to us and said, well, you know, we'd really like to have the whole county as a military training area. So it went on a little bit longer. And in the end, we found out that the two Lancasters who were behind the whole thing, who wanted to trade the land from Santa Rosa Island for the 64,000 acres over near Goose Pasture, some of y'all might know where Goose Pasture is, those two guys were arrested. They had promised to, a lot of money was involved. They had taken $11 million from people who invested in this idea that they had to develop Santa Rosa Island, and those guys are still in prison. One of them's name, if you want to look it up, is Stephen Alford, and his attorney's name was David Fleet. They gave us a lot of headaches in Taylor County for about 3 years, and the Air Force was a big part of it. Colonel Nolan was the big guy who was at Air Force Base in England, and after that he got a promotion and went to the Pentagon. So doing something bad doesn't necessarily mean that the Air Force guys get slapped on the hand, they might get a promotion. So all this, I'm saying all this, because during all the time that we were dealing with the Air Force, we were lied to again and again and again. At the beginning of it, it sounded real simple. And as we learned more, it got worse and worse. We learned that they would be using all kinds of weapons and depleted uranium. they would be blowing up that great big Moab bomb. They were having trouble over at Pensacola with people complaining about the noise over there. So they wanted to move it over there to us. And I can't tell you the sleepless nights I had thinking about how there would be military training going on a quarter of a mile from my house, and I wouldn't be able to do anything about it. So you all just need to stand firm. Don't give in. I'm hoping that the Forest Service listens. I'm hoping that we can talk to Adam Putnam and maybe get him to realize how serious this is for the people of the county here, of the people of this area. They depend on Tate's Forest, Tate's Hill, for a lot of things. They go fishing there, they go hunting there. A lot of people supplement their food with what they catch and kill from the state's forest. And they should. That's what it's there for. That's why Tate's Hill is what it is. In the past, Buckeye Cellulose, Buckeye Florida, Procter & Gamble owned the land there, and they timbered it. And I can't tell you how happy I was when I found out the state was going to buy that land. I've been dealing with Buckeye for many years of my life because of the pollution in Taylor County. So I was very, very happy when it did become owned by the state and that the people could use it in the county. And what y'all want to do is just not a compatible use for what it is that these people need. And it's not compatible with what Tate's Hill should be. If you just need a place to land a bunch of planes, you can go over to Dixie County. There's a road there called the Road to Nowhere. And on the coast, you can go over there, land, and take off all you want to do. Up and down, or this way, whatever way you want to do it. You won't bother anybody because there ain't nobody around here. But I'm thinking that perhaps you could do this over in Eglin. Don't you have almost 500,000 acres over there? How much land is there?
724 square miles.
How many
acres is that?
464,000.
Almost
500,000 acres.
Now, you don't have any straight roads in there?
Can
I respond to that? Okay. So, at the beginning of this, we did a study, and we took all the folks who needed to use the Eglin Range. And when you take all the folks and all the different missions across, not just Eglin, but across Northwest Florida, and in Alabama, some folks come down there. When you take all those folks and you put them onto the Eglin Range, they don't all fit.
They don't all fit.
As hard as it is to believe, they don't all fit.
Well, you're saying that this is a problem with scheduling.
No. We tried with different scheduling. And what we found was there was not even enough scheduling flexibility to make it work. So that's why we're looking for other ways to create flexibility. It doesn't happen all the time, but what it does is it happens enough, and it happens those times when we need it, that it causes mission failure. So we either have mission failure, or we need to find ways to create flexibility to increase our missions.
Can't transport some of those guys to stay over at the Ocala National Forest and the Bombing Range there, so they can stay there for a month and do whatever training you need to do. Why can't you go down to Davon Park Bombing Range?
Like I said, we are looking at all different possibilities. This was a possibility in discussions with the Forest Service. They said this might be something they were willing to talk about, so we're talking about it. If we get to the end of this process and find out that it's not a reality, or we find out that we just can't do what it is we need to do, then we will look at other options. We've got other options out there that we're looking at. This is one that we're pursuing because the state was willing to talk to us.
From what I've read, you've got 20 million acres in the nation to do training on. 20 million acres seems like enough for me. Is Adam Putnam your boss?
Yes, he is.
Well, I'm going to go talk to him. Well, he'll be a good guy.
Thank you, sir. Charles Brennan?
Who?
Charles Brennan?
Are you back there? I'm Charles Brandon, president of the Franklin County Dog Hunters Association. We're about 350 strong. Start with, Thanksgiving was hunting season. I'm sitting on my dog box listening to my dog run. I hear a helicopter come across. It wasn't real loud, didn't bother me none. 3 hours later, my wife life flighted from Apalachicola to Tallahassee. 3 hours ago was the first time she got to breathe on her own for 3 hours. And for the Air Force to come in and try to take over that type of airspace is a no-no. That dog won't hunt. We need our life flights able to fly everywhere they need to go. I came back from Tallahassee seeing her one night, a wreck on 98 up there. They could have brought a chopper in there, but they didn't have room to put it down. But we need places in our airspace that these choppers can go to and land without y'all coming in and messing them up. Some of my questions I had that have already been answered, but I don't think we got the right answers. If y'all come in here and train, how many years are y'all trying to take it over? Is one of them.
Well, first of all, we're not trying to take it over.
You're what?
We're not trying to take it over. We're trying to be a compatible use. We're trying to be another permitted user of the forest. Okay. So,
can you guarantee that?
Can I guarantee that? Mm-hmm. That is our intent. That is what we have stated in our EIS, that we
are there for sure than not.
And there's no guarantee that these choppers and planes and automobiles out here are not going to crash and spill into the creeks and the streams. You can't guarantee that.
Nobody can guarantee that.
Right.
Exactly.
We don't need that, is what I'm getting at. Y'all can move somewhere else where they don't have oysters and fish out there that these people here have to make a living off of. There's other places to move to. Y'all just trying to shove this down our throat, and we ain't going to accept it. I slept 24 hours in the past 15 days. And to come to this meeting right here, I'm fed up with y'all. I've had enough.
Marilyn Faber.
Hi, I'm from Quincy, Florida. And we spend a lot of time in Tate's Hill. Because just as Leslie says, it's a gem of a recreational spot. As a paddler, a kayak, and the primitive camp in tents, as old as we are, we're down to the ground in air mattresses, and we really enjoy it. This spring, I got 85 people signed up from Jacksonville all the way to Ocean Springs to Walnut Creek, so we could paddle Walnut Creek, Crooked River, New River, Graham Creek. I could have added Deep Creek, Whiskey George, Cache Creek. You've got so many rivers. If you just camp one spot in Tate's Hill, within half an hour, you're within a good paddling river. No place else in Florida, I am saying, no place can you have that. You have to shuttle 1 hour and back. Tate's Hill, you camp there, paddle 6-7 rivers. We've done that. You've got a gem. But if you're primitive camp, and there's we've gone from Sumatra all the way down to Carabel on the Mule. Primitive camping on all those great sites, okay? Now, what's going to happen if you have helicopter flights there at night? Forget it. I camped last December 6th on a sandbank in Blackwater River State Forest. If I had our 4-year-old granddaughter with us, that would be the end of any wilderness experience for that grandchild. She would have been frightened to death. And no amount of my bribing her would have gotten her back into a tent at night. It was frightening. And so I'm saying you need to keep your the helicopters flying at tree level. And you're camping there and you think, wow, what a beautiful river. And then you hear this helicopter. It's frightening. You don't expect it. 4-year-old kid would be frightened. Now the other person who talked, Michael, who talked about water. I was reading one of the appendixes to the Blackwater, one of your monitoring trips. They were saying, you need to sample the water. You know what the forest manager said? Water is not our concern. Go read your own appendixes. That's what he said. Water that empties into the Apalachicola and East Bay is a concern. The kind of insects that can thrive, the kind of eggs that can thrive, if you get too much pH, you don't have too much oxygen, all of these things affect the kind of fish you have in your waters. You have to test your waters. You know, when I read that, I said, I can't believe that you're saying water is not our concern. Now, I think you made a very good point about water, because that is not often considered as a baseline criteria. Now, those are not what I planned to say. I wanted to ask two questions. One, currently, the Tate's Hill Management Plan does not allow for any military incursions, unlike the one that the Blackwater Plan that's being considered tomorrow does contain. So how are you going to justify this kind of incursion when nothing in the management plan currently calls for that? One question. Secondly, you know, I'm very naive about physics. I absolutely hated it. And I know this is one section about emitters, and I've been asking people, what's this about emitters? Can it? Then I read in one of the proposals that the Air Force may change frequencies if the emitters used in the training would interfere with civilian communication. And I'm saying, is it after the fact that they're going to change the communication? That's the only way they're going to know. So my second question, I guess, would be to the Air Force. What's this about frequencies that might be able to create some kind of adverse condition on the civilian population? So the first question I think I'd ask of forestry, how do you plan to justify the military under the current Tate's Hill plan? And the second one is on emitters.
A couple of your questions I heard. One was water quality. We are the Florida Forest Service. We are extremely concerned with water quality, but the Northwest Florida Water Management District monitors our water. Okay? It gets monitored, but not by us.
But read your own response.
The response was that we're not responsible for the monitoring. The Northwest Florida Water Management District is. Okay? So they do monitor it. If we consider a use that is not contemplated in the management plan, that use has to go before the Acquisition and Restoration Council as an amendment to that plan. It will be heard at a regularly scheduled public meeting, and it will be aired. If it's voted up, it will be allowed. If it's voted down, it will be disallowed. Something that the folks here with Tate's Hill may remember is when Representative Kendrick wanted to do and have an off-highway vehicle park in Tate's Hill. That use was not allowed. That use was not allowed in the management plan. What we did was we designed an off-highway vehicle park. We went to ARC. We did all of the environmental studies. ARC approved it, and it was amended into the plan. So now there's an off-highway vehicle park in Tate's Hill State Forest. So I hope that answers those questions. What was the
question? You said that you would have an amendment in the ARC and bring this before ARC. There's another question that, because this is not something that your track record is very good at. Will you be transparent? Will the draft be available to the public? Will the public have a chance to read the draft, have a hearing, to have a feedback before you submit a finished amendment to the ARC?
state of Florida has well-defined processes in rule and statute for the operation of law within this state. Florida is an open state. There's a sunshine law. Everything the state of Florida does is available to you if you make a public records request. When we are going to ARC with an amendment, generally speaking, that's posted 2 months before the meeting. ARC meetings are every other month, and generally they're agendaed 2 months. No, we do not call everybody individually, but DEP has it on their website, we have it on our website, it is in a publicly scheduled meeting, and the agenda is available. So yes, you do have 2 months to address whatever concerns you have. You just told me that you reviewed concerns that someone had about our management plan, about our water quality. That's exactly what they were doing.
Do you know where I got that from?
They were opining on our plan.
It's so difficult to get information. I managed to get this by finding someone who happened to be on an advisory committee of your Blackwater Forest plan. I had no way. If I went to the web, there's a 5-year plan, there's no 10-year plan. I called DEP, I asked them for the 10-year plan. I even had an email from Forestry when I requested a draft of that plan. I have that document in my at home saying the plan is not available. The plan was not posted until last Thursday.
I don't think that's the case, but I can't argue there right now.
Well, I would like to know about the emitters.
Oh, okay, so I think your third question and...
The frequencies on the emitters, how is that going to affect civilian communication?
Okay, so I'm not quite sure what you're referring to, but I'll give you a general answer, and hopefully that'll cover your concerns. First, we're not planning to do anything that is intrinsically unhazardous or hazardous outside of areas we already own. So any sort of emitter, and typically for our purposes that's really only lasers, is regulated by the Federal Communications Commission and is conducted in areas that we can exclude other people. So that's not what we're asking for here or considering. We are looking at using radar emitters at certain locations. Those are specific locations, and you'll see in the draft, that, and I think in the scoping materials as well, most of those are not actually in the contiguous state forest. But irrespective of that, the FCC gives us a bandwidth. So they allocate bandwidth, and I say bandwidth, that means a set of frequencies from one point to another, and it's actually a logarithmic scale, so it's not like 1 to 10, it's like 1 to 10, and then 10 to 1,000, and then so it's megahertz and kilohertz and those sorts of things. But they authorize a certain set of frequencies for a particular use. I'll give you an example, FM radio. That is a set of frequencies that's authorized for a particular use, and the FCC licenses your radio station to transmit a particular area at a particular power, and we get the same before we can transmit as well. So we go to the FCC and say, if we're going to transmit, use a radar or anything, we say, okay, can we have an authority to operate? And they would license that. Now, what I think that you saw was that over the course of the last 10 years with the proliferation of wireless devices, that the FCC has continued to sell off bandwidth or frequency, sets of frequencies that the military used to be able to use. And that's impacted the way we operate and given made it harder for us to do our things because you know the ability to communicate is very important to military operations. So I think what you're seeing is the FCC licenses activities based on their power at particular bandwidth ranges because then they say, well, okay, so there's a radio station in Panama City that transmits at whatever frequency. We can authorize the same frequency in San Francisco because they never will touch. So we have to go ask for authorization to transmit And I think what you're seeing is that process where the FCC says, okay, you can do this here, or you can't do that there. It's not a safety issue. What it is an issue is two things that are operating together to step on each other. I'll give you an example. We do have on one of the military frequencies that is given to us, the people that make garage door openers thought, well, our garage door opener is such a low power that we'll just use that and not ask for permission because it's not licensed.
Is that why the Crestview garage doors will open?
So at some point, we used our own frequency and opened everybody's garage door.
That's what I heard. Yeah.
So we immediately used it against our vehicle. So that's an example of the way that gets coordinated. So I understand your concern, but there's a lot of safety parts that wrap around that, and nothing that we're looking at is intrinsically hazardous for those emitters. Now, there may be a safety distance of 2 or 3 feet or 10 feet in front of the thing that they would, you know, they would make sure a post guard put inside a fence or something so that people wouldn't walk directly in front of the emitter.
Would it affect the transmitting powers of dogs?
If they're on the wrong frequency, we'll be on the right one. So
the dogs would be on the wrong frequency.
I don't know that. I do know that we will abide by the FCC rules for us. So if we have another, you know, garage door thing, then
I'm more worried about cell phone because most people don't have land phones and emergency phones are cell phones.
Yeah, those while those that set of frequencies has impinged on a certain type of operations and a certain type of communication ability that we used to have, we're pretty good at staying away from that stuff. I mean, it's very highly regulated and it's not a safety concern. So, thank you for your question.
Ed,
Fever? You just about addressed one of the main issues. I wanted to just make sure I understood. I think what you said is that if there is a plan change, in other words, if there's anything that's going to affect Tate's health, that would be an amendment presented to the ARC at the Acquisition and Restoration Council.
Yes, sir.
And they would have to approve it.
Yes, sir.
I would hope, given all that's happened in the last 2 days, I don't know if it's 2 days or three anymore, I'm kind of worn out, but that you would realize from all that you've heard from both the West Florida community and this community, how critical it is to get information to people soon. And you just can't rely on posting something with this kind of concern and attention to two major parts of this panel. So I just hope you'll make a commitment to us that if there is anything that has to go as a plan amendment, mm-hmm. that we all know about that, with plenty of time to talk about it. And there's ways you've got now all our names.
I cannot make a promise that you would know. What I can make a promise is that we do learn. And we continue to learn, and we are certainly extremely very well aware that there are concerned citizens with both Blackwater and Franklin County and Liberty County with Tate's Health. We'll make every effort to let everyone know and have input, and that's why we're here tonight.
Now, I know another second part, and I appreciate that. I think you will be sincere about that. But tomorrow, the ARC is meeting again.
Correct.
Some of the people here met with the ARC this morning and testified about this issue. There is still a pending issue, and that is whether once a plan is going to be submitted or is prepared and has to come to the ARC, the issue as I understood it, and it was a bit confusing on that issue, on that point, there's still some discussion about whether they could go ahead without the ARC's approval. Forestry could go ahead with that.
Okay, let me clarify. You were at the meeting, and I remember, and if you recall, there was some discussion about what language may be included in the plan that would give folks a comfort factor that whatever was going in would be, you know, aired, approved, and put in. And we're very comfortable with that. We don't want to put anything in there without everybody being comfortable. And what happened today is that plan, voting on it, was postponed until tomorrow, until that language could be drafted. And then our attorneys have looked at it, and Director Carls has looked at it, and we've put it together, and we have that language. And basically, I can tell you what the language says, that once we get to a point that we have a final draft, after everything is a final draft for an operations plan, that final draft will be taken to ARC. And if approved, it will be amended into the plan. So that little piece of what we do that talks about the military won't just be mentioned in the plan. The entire agreement will be amended into the plan. It will become an addendum. So it will be there for everybody to see. Let me go back and just this one thing that your wife has talked about, and Director Carl's talked about. The Forest Service is a multi-use manager. We're not like, I don't know if you're aware of this, but Rec and Parks, they're single-use manager. They manage for one purpose, and their statutory task for managing land at Rec and Parks is recreation. That's what their focus is. We're a multi-use land manager. That means that we're tasked by the legislature to try to accommodate as many uses, public uses, as we can on the forest, and we're also tasked with practicing sustainable forestry. And I've heard here in this meeting and two or three meetings over about the military, the military, the military, the military. And I understand that. Trust me, I do. But saying the military does not identify a particular use. We're looking at particular uses. And what I mean by that is if we have a group of five people that are camping at a campsite, and they have a permit to camp at that campsite, if that same five people were federal employees, we do not have the right to refuse them the opportunity to camp at that campsite. Now, I don't know if that makes sense, but that's what we have to deal with. If you have open hunting and you allow people to drive on the road from point A to point B, and they have a forest use permit to go from point A to point B, we can't refuse these guys that same right just because they have a uniform on. So we're looking at forest uses, not a military use, but a forest use. Is it compatible with resources? We don't know. And that's what we're going through. I can't tell you that everything's perfect. I can't tell you that if the military is out there that they won't run off the road and have a wreck. I can't tell you if I'm out there that I won't run off the road and have a wreck. You know, we're going to scrutinize this as much as we can, but we have to scrutinize it realistically. We can't hold everybody else to a whole much higher standard than we hold ourselves to. We fly helicopters out there. We dip water out of ponds. We put fires out. I want to make a point of something. The Forest Service, this guy runs a group called the Florida Forest Service, and we manage 35 state forests and 1 million acres. But he is also responsible for all the wildfire in the state of Florida. Florida is one of the two or three top wildfire states in the country. This guy runs that program. He knows aircraft. He runs aircraft. We own aircraft. We manage aircraft. We loan aircraft to other states. He puts foresters in other states. We've got fire crews all over the country. Probably one of the best in the country is the state of Florida. So it's not like we started doing these types of things yesterday. And I understand the scrutiny. I'm from here. I love Tate Sale. But I saw what Buckeye did to it. I saw what happened when it was dredged and drained and timbered. But I see it now. And in just the last 15 or 20 years, go look at it now and look at it what it was 40 years ago. There are people that love it just as much as you do, and we're trying to come to a common ground here. And we may never do that, but we don't know that until we run through these exercises. They may never step foot on it. But at least when we get to that point to make that decision, we'll say we considered all the science, we considered everything that wasn't just our opinion. Here's what we looked at. And that's where we're going. And we want you to hold us accountable. We want to be here. We want to be in the public, and we want to answer the questions. So we're not going away. We're here.
Let me just say, I understand that. I appreciate that. We've got to know a lot of forest folks, a lot of the Florida Forest Service people. They're great people. Everybody that we have gotten to know has been competent, seems to love this forest, seems to want to do the right thing. That is not the issue. We respect what you've done, and we certainly can see the pictures and seen the changes from years ago and where it is today. And it's all the credit to you for getting that done. So we don't have any problem with that whatsoever. The military is not an individual person. It's just similar to saying that a corporation is a person, but in reverse. When we say the military ought to be able to do the same thing because they're individual people, that's a stretch. I mean, that really is a logical stretch. They are an institution with lots of power. Lots of power. More power than the Forest Service, I hate to say. And if they get their foots in here, that's a different situation altogether. They're not people who are just like you and me and the rest of us who want to go out and battle. That's just not the proper analogy. So anyway, I only have one other thing to mention. It's only because this is a very important body. This Acquisition and Restoration Council, I never heard of it before. I should have, but it's not my area. They met today, and some of you were there. There are a lot of people from West Florida there to talk. I don't think those people had any idea of what this means to us. That's not to say they were bad people. Some of them are foresters who I know believe in conservation and restoration. They didn't have a feel for this. I thought I was talking to a wall. There's so much depth in this. They should be here. ARC members, now I know you're a member of ARC, and you're a member of ARC, and you certainly understand that. And I think maybe they would understand if they could just hear you and hear people say. But they don't. They're very important. They're going to say yes or no to this. And they don't have a feel for it. They honestly do not have any feel for it. And that ought to be corrected. I don't know how to do it. If I were running that council, all of them would have been here tonight.
While we're talking about the plan, the management plan, yeah, were you all talking about the ARC meeting today? Was that to vote on the Tate's Hill management plan?
No. Tate's Hill was approved in 2007. Mm-hmm. Public hearing was held right in this room, and there was more of our shirts here than the general public, but it's approved for 10 years. So what John was talking about is if another activity like the OHV that's not in that plan that's already approved comes up, then it will go to ARC and get reviewed. The Blackwater River State Forest Plan was up for approval this morning.
Can I just answer this?
Let's get to the last speaker. I mean, did that answer your question?
Well, I know that I was on the review
team. Afterwards.
I was on the review team last fall. We were reviewing the management plan, mm-hmm. and we received a draft, but to look at.
For which plan?
The Tate's Hill plan.
Just the review that we have here on the state forest.
Oh, the review, okay.
The review.
In between the 10-year plan approval, they have a land management review.
Review, okay.
They try to do it right 5 years in between, and they kind of come out, and this panel comes out and reviews, how are we doing? Are we following the plan? Okay, so then those comments and your comments and everybody's comments gets filtered in, and then that gives us time to adjust the next plan, which should be due in 2017.
Yeah, that wasn't a draft you had. That was an actual plan.
Right. And then after the comments, we received the comments, and they were all together.
Okay.
Mr. Weber, just a short thing.
Okay.
I was very disappointed, Mr. Brown, that you didn't mention on your own, and we had to mention to the group that the ARC was still considering the Blackwater plan tomorrow, and people can still be heard on this one little part that he talked about. This is what we mean by transparency.
That's right.
There is not that willingness to tell you that you can still be heard, not on Tate's Hill, but you know what happens in Blackwater is going to impact us. And many of us went because, not because of Blackwater, we went because of Tate's Hill. Cheryl was there this morning. And he never volunteered that information. He should have. If he really wanted our public input, he would have said, go and testify tomorrow. You can testify at the ARC, either at 9, it's going to be the first thing on the agenda, and tell them what you're thinking. Tell them that you really need to put teeth in this amendment. Tell them that they really have to take seriously any amendments. Tell them that particularly when it comes to the military, you want them to be extra vigilant. You can still testify. But you know, he never told us that. We had to tell you that. That is part of our job. Sunshine says, public officials are supposed to tell us this. That's all we're asking you. Let us know about it. That's what's called transparency. Tell us when we can give inputs. That's called democracy.
John Little.
I've missed all of your meetings. I don't know any of you people that are here. I'm from Holmes County. And the way I understand this is this Tate's Hill Forest belongs to the people of the state of Florida. Is that correct?
Yes, absolutely.
So that means all the people in the state of Florida could have a say on what takes place to their property. Is that correct?
Sure.
Okay. Well, I'm in the learning process. And I would like to bring it to your attention. Ronald Reagan said that the 9 or 10 most dreaded words that an American citizen can hear is, I'm the government and I'm here to help. This is nothing to do with any animosities toward any of your agencies. But we have several bureaucratic agencies working to please us. And this hasn't been done very well in the United States recently. I retired from the back gate of Eglin Air Force Base. I live about an hour from there now. I live about 30 or 40 minutes from Fort Rooker. I'm about an hour from Site 6. So I'm very familiar with the guns and the bombs and the jets and all of this. According to a Reuters report, the Pentagon is the biggest landowner in the world. It owns 5,000 sites in 41 countries. Leon Panetta said, the Department of Defense, I'm sorry to say, is the only major federal agency that cannot pass an audit. So, what I would like to see is the people have more of a say than the bureaucratic entities. And I think that just based on what I'm hearing these people say right now, I think that's the only thing they're asking for. It's their property and they want to say. And they want your help. And I'm supposedly an outsider, but I own a little bit of that land out there. And I want to say on who steps on it. and what takes place. It has nothing whatsoever to do with the United States military. I don't know of any instance in my 68 years where the United States military has been sued individually for violating any wildlife treaties or any pollution. If you own 5,000 sites in the world, you instantly become a large polluter. I don't know about this ARC. I don't know what that is, and I don't know about the Forestry Department. I'm sure they do a good job. But what we have here is a problem in the country. And that's what you're hearing these people say. They're dissatisfied with the way they're being treated.
All the speakers we had signed up, unless there's any more, but one more. Sure. Sure, come on up.
I've got to get home. My husband's sleep probably in the car. Is he okay? I'm Cheryl Sanders, and I happen to be the fifth generation of Franklin County. I'm proud of it. And just to let you know, we had the eighth generation, the first of the eighth generation, last night. So we've been here a long, long time. And I spoke before the ARC committee today, and what I did was I read the letter that Franklin County Board of County Commissioners wrote on September 4th. And I had to ask John Brown, he was saying the user groups, that you have to look at the different user groups, and that if the military wants to come in and land planes and helicopters, that's something to look at. But at the same time, if you're going to afford the military the possibility of landing aircraft in and out of the forest, are we going to do civilian also, if they petition? So, you know, back in the 90s, when we came forward and supported the land to be sold to the state of Florida, it was not for military usage. It was for protection of this bay out here and for our traditional uses. I've lived in this forest all my life, and I think Harvard can tell you that. And there ain't an inch of that forest I don't know. And I'm going to tell you something. We have hunt season that starts in September, and it runs on through April. The only time, if you're not going to do any kind of military operation, you know, during hunting season, the only time you're going to be able to do it is during May to August. And I can tell you, New River is about that deep in the summertime. You're not going to be parachuting men in the river. You're going to be parachuting them on the ground. I mean, the fact is, I'm being serious about this, though. It's not the terrain that needs to be trained on for the military. And the ditches, oh my Lord, the ditches, you could lose a truck in one of them ditches. I know I've lost a couple of them, you know. But what I'm saying is, back in the 90s, the only acquisition that I didn't sit on the Board of County Commissioners and approve was the original acquisition back in the early 90s, and that was the original, I think, 88,000 acres, the original 85,000, something like that. But the other ones, I have sat on that Board of County Commissioners every time, and you know what I did? I even went and talked to ARC back when Jack Mo was on there, Mola, and I supported it. I supported the sale of the land to the state of Florida. Why? Because I knew it would protect. And it would give us the opportunity to use the land as we had before in all of our lives. And I did not know. And this is nothing against military. And Lord knows I'm not against military, even though I've been bashed about it, okay? Let's be fair. You know, everybody has an opinion. But I know what's up in them woods. I live in the middle of them woods. I have the honor of living in the middle of those woods, and I take care of them. I don't throw trash out. I don't do anything that you're not supposed to do. And I could tell you some stuff that does get done, but don't never tell it. But, in all honesty, the forest is meant for all people, even the military. To let y'all know, we've been having military operations in Franklin County for several years. In fact, Franklin County Commission about a month ago got an award for our participation on supporting the military, because they came in through the Emerald Warrior Project, and they have been leasing land, private land, to do their training zone. Let it stay at that. Let it stay at that. We don't need no more military in Franklin County. In this article you got in here, and I don't have my glasses. Okay, it says the military employment makes up 46% of all the jobs in Northwest Florida and generates more than $14.8 billion in annual economic impact. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of jobs. And we sacrificed our jobs for preservation that day out there. And my daddy, his last words to me on his dying deathbed was, "Cheryl, love the forest as long as you can. Leave it better than you found it." And that's what our job is to leave it better than what we found it. That's for our future generations. So I would say, I would ask, and I'm going to ask because I did it in the scoping meeting and nobody listened to me, but I would ask of the forestry and of the military to pull back, to say there's no need for Franklin County or for Tateshill to be involved in this, and take no action. Just like I asked you back in August, not to take no action on this. It's not that we don't want y'all here, but y'all don't need to be here. We've got too much precious resources to even think that you might disturb it. And the most precious resource we got is our people. So thank you very much for letting me speak, Ken, again. And I'm going to leave y'all for now.
Thank you all.